To all the educators, participants, viewing on our YouTube channel, friends, ladies, and gentlemen, happy Teacher's Day and a very great day to all of you. It is a great honor for me to be with you today to give this introduction on Teacher Leadership Webinar. SEAMEO is one with the global education community in celebrating World Teacher's Day with the theme Teachers, Leading in Crisis, Reimagining the Future. It takes a village to raise a child, according to an African proverb, but that challenge is more felt if you are a teacher. As a teacher myself, I am very much aware of the various aspects of leadership that we need to exhibit in this new normal. Classroom leadership, school leadership, and community leadership in general. When COVID-19 pandemic ravaged the globe and closed down school after school after school, community after community after community, and the world, SEAMEO immediately launched a number of online learning programs meant to address the needs of teachers and education stakeholders in Southeast Asia. We are able to reach more than 500,000 of educators from all over the world through our SEAMEO webinar series, SEAMEO lecture series, and e-forums. When we were conceptualizing and leading all of these initiatives, I had one guiding framework in my mind, that learning must continue despite the lockdowns. The COVID-19 pandemic has brought to the forefront swift and fast innovation learning programs and projects that we have to do in this time of crisis. But the main challenge is, how do we reach as many teachers as possible, as many learners as possible? The question triggered the birth of the SEAMEO web seminar or webinar and virtual classroom series. The forum started as early as March, in mid-March. It has been going up until now. And the celebration of the World Teachers Day gave us the opportunity to contemplate further on this multi-pronged approach. The SEAMEO launched to respond to the crisis. This year's theme of World Teachers Day highlighted the need for leadership, getting on with the task. At the classroom level, the teachers have to develop lots of materials online, whether video, synchronous, or asynchronous. School leadership, you need to work with a community of teachers to be able to ensure that learning is of good quality, relevant, and accessible to all. This is at the MESO level. And at the community level leadership, I see a lot of teachers who are working with the community, local government units, ministries of education, to be able to generate more and more resources for their online learning. The innovative lectures featured more than 100 video clips from now that we would like to share to the whole community. The reason is that some teachers have no preparation to be able to teach online. So the classroom teachers need to design lessons through social media applications, gamification, and even having virtual tours and virtual classroom management. At the school level leadership, we enrich the knowledge of our participants on recent trends and approaches in school reopening, school rehabilitation, health and sanitation protocols. We introduce the 3 R's of school rehabilitation, that is re-engagement, rehabilitation, and what to do for resurgence planning. We have also made sure that all interventions at the school level are compliant with the accepted safety protocols and covered not just physical, but also emotional preparation of learners and under the teacher's care. Finally, at the community level, we have engaged the ministers of education in special ministerial policy e-forum on COVID-19 response, where the ministers highlighted the evolving and expanding role of teachers during this pandemic, as well as making sure that even the displaced, the disadvantaged are reached by education interventions. We have also launched our webinars, open educational resources, our virtual classroom to discuss social financial literacy, e-forum, reaching the unreached, you know, learning for special education for children with disabilities, and the annual forum for basic education on actually the sustainable development goal number 4, making education accessible and of good quality and promoting lifelong learning for all. Making sure that preparations are parallel with the developments in the communities where schools operate. After reaching more than 600,000 educators in Southeast Asia, in just a few months, more needs to be done. And I'm confident that there are silver linings during this COVID-19 pandemic. This would include accelerated growth of not just online technologies, but the parallel growth experienced by other delivery modalities. The radio and television, which were actually popular in the 70s, are back. There is a resurgence in the development of innovative video clips, TV and radio broadcasts to ensure that online technologies are there. Self-paced learning modules have also been developed, and these are led largely by the ministries of education. In all of this development, one thing remains clear. The roles of teachers are crucial and very important. And despite the advancement, the technological tools, teachers could never be replaced. So thank you very much for your time, and I hope you will enjoy this month of World Teachers Day celebration. Have a good time.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Ethel, for welcoming all our participants. And I'm Rafi, and with me.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Pia Pa, SEAMEO Secretariat.
So thank you for joining us for this SEAMEO special lecture on leading transformational teaching in the new normal. So today is Thursday, another Learning Thursday for this special lecture for our teachers in celebration of the World Teachers Day and the 55th anniversary of SEAMEO. So we have two keynote speakers for this special lecture. And Piapa, would you like to introduce our first keynote speaker?
Okay, let's welcome the first keynote speaker, Dr. Lucio Sia Jr., Program Specialist from UNESCO Paris. So you will hear from his suggestions that what knowledge and skills that teacher needs for the transforming and maximizing the learning process of the student during the COVID pandemic. Please enjoy his presentation.
Good morning from Paris, ladies and gentlemen, fellow educators, teachers, and friends. First of all, I would like to thank the Southeast Asian Ministers of Education Organization, SEAMEO in short, and particularly Dr. Ethel Agnes Valenzuela, Director of the SEAMEO Secretariat, for having invited me to provide this keynote on this timely lecture on leading transformational teaching in the new normal. Transformational teaching is based on the idea that an instructor's purpose is more than just the delivery of information. Rather than being content focused, transformational teachers help students become critical participants in the learning process and well-drilled at critical thinking, goal setting, and reflection. As we might be aware, COVID-19 has affected 1.6 billion learners, or 90% of the world's total student population, with the closure of schools. According to UNESCO, this has affected over 63 million teachers. Obviously, this is a challenge to teachers who have to work in this strange new situation and to lead during this crisis while reimagining the future and the new normal. Teachers have to be resilient leaders, and they have in fact proven to be so in many instances where they have been acting spontaneously at the classroom level, the school level, and at the community level, so that no one is left behind. Teachers have to be innovative and creative, not only with pedagogy and learning skills, ICT skills and technical skills, but also, even more importantly, with social emotional skills or soft skills, which involve communication, teamwork, adaptability, problem solving, creativity, work ethic, interpersonal skills, time management, leadership, and attention to details. So transformational teachers are those that help students become critical participants in the learning process and well-practiced critical thinking, goal setting, and reflection. There are many challenges to the new normal, whether in formal education, non-formal education, or informal education, where teachers as leaders are faced with and will continue to face these challenges. Challenges include equity and inclusion, access to social services, connectivity in both high-tech or low-tech situations. This would involve engaging with families, developing resources in different target groups, including disadvantaged groups, ethnic groups, and groups with disabilities, which Dr. Ethel Valenzuela discussed with UNESCO's Global Teacher Campus in line with the World Teachers Day celebrations last week. So teacher leadership means knowing the learners and how they learn, knowing the content and teaching strategies of the teaching area and how to teach it, planning and implementing effective teaching and learning, creating a supportive and safe learning environment, engaging professionally with colleagues, parents, caregivers, carers, and the community. It is hoped and expected that national policies of SEAMEO member states would promote and provide support to teachers for leadership during crisis. No country, as far as I know, was actually prepared for this crisis. But innovative teachers do not wait for governments to tell them what to do. UNESCO discussed, for instance, how teachers started to use technology in reaching out to their learners via WhatsApp, YouTube, SMS, promoting remote learning and exercising leadership by creating a larger network, working collaboratively, leading communities through communities of practice, and putting this to scale to adapt and find solutions. I would like to end this keynote by citing a short poem by Laura Kelly Fanucci on her thoughts when this COVID-19 is over. When this is over, may we never again take for granted a handshake with a stranger, full shelves at the store, conversations with neighbors, a crowded theater, Friday night out, the taste of communion, a routine checkup, the school rush each morning, coffee with a friend, the stadium roaring, each deep breath, a boring Tuesday, life itself. When this ends, may we find that we have become more like the people we wanted to be, we were called to be, we hoped to be, and may we stay that way, better for each other, because of the worse. So let's continue to support one another through all challenges we are facing and determine that they will bring from us our very best. Thank you and have a good, great webinar, everyone.
Thank you very much for the comprehensive suggestion, Dr. Lucio Sia Jr. And thank you very much for the video from the Paris. So Rafi, how's the next speaker?
Okay, our next keynote speaker is the Chief of Education from UNESCO New Delhi, Mr. Omar Diop, and he will talk about the transformational teaching and the critical concepts, the theories about it. So let's enjoy this video presentation.
Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. I'm delighted to be here, and I would like to thank Dr. Ethel and the SEAMEO Secretariat for having me as a guest for this special lecture on leading transformative teaching in the new normal. My name is Omar Diop, and I'm heading the education sector at the UNESCO New Delhi office. And today, I'll be talking about the teaching in the new normal and the transformational teaching. My address will be structured in three main points. The first one being the transformative pedagogy. What does it mean? What is it? And the second will be then looking at the processes and the outcomes of teaching, transformational teaching. And the third part of my address will address how to support learning, resilience building, and learners' well-being during these unprecedented times. The purpose of the transformative pedagogy is to support teachers to create innovative learning processes that empowers learners and engages them as whole persons in participatory and collaborative activities. Activities that could contribute to their sense of self. Transformative pedagogy also helps to build children's resilience, and it also strengthens their socio-emotional well-being, meaning that it empowers them to be able to overcome certain situations of frustrations, and of course that this time is kind of imposing us. It fosters also solidarity and interconnectedness of life. Solidarity meaning we are all in this together, and learners being able to share and then to connect themselves to some kind of reality that everybody and society is living and going through these days. Active participation of learners is key. It's a key element and a key principle to this transformation process. How learning takes place also is not just one way or dual way. It's quite of a more complex ways with interconnectedness between the peers, so between the learners, between the teachers to the learners, and the teachers to the individual. So it's a dynamic process. Formative pedagogy, key elements. So we need that context sensitivity. We need the participatory and collaborative learning. We need to support learner-led action. We need safe learning environment, and we need a whole approach, whole school approach, and role modeling. We can have role models within the groups, we can have role models within the school, we can have role models within the family. And of course, the safe learning environment is quite important because then after you can be inclusive in the way you organize the learners, and then the horizontal and trusting relationship and the acknowledgement and addresses of the dynamics. So facilitation and then distributed leaderships are quite key about transformational teaching when we talk about transformative pedagogy. When we talk about transformative pedagogies, of course, one has to be clear on the processes and also the outcome. One first example I can cite here is how do you engage the engagement, how do you engage physically, mentally, and then emotionally? Because in these unprecedented times that we found ourselves, then people are realizing that the dimension of the mental and the emotional well-being is quite important when we talk about the learning processes. Of course, so we need now this engagement of physical, mental, and emotional to be done, and that is that's the process, actually, that kind of engagement. And what would be the outcome? The outcome would be the sense of self. I realize myself, and then confidence and all building oneself. Self-driven learning also as a process, as an input. Self-driven learning, children as actors of their own learning processes, that would kind of lead to some kind of emotional relief. Reflection, self-reflection, that can also is a quite interesting and important dimension of the whole processes. Self-reflection and then reflection, that would lead to some kind of resilience. And this resilience is quite important in the new normal, because we have been having this pandemic and we've been through this crisis of the COVID-19. But even if the cases are now diminishing, we have always this risk of having other pandemics on board and other crises which can affect the learning and the schools. So we that reflection is quite important, and it would lead to some kind of resilience as an outcome. Innovation and creativity would be then the input and the process, and which would lead to some kind of generation of new knowledge. Now, all of it, of course, it has to be inclusive. Inclusive because there are people with different status, and of course, learners with different status, learners with different capacities, learners with different abilities. And if we are inclusive in the whole approach, then the outcome will lead us to the empowerment of the learners as a group and as individuals. The basic requirements are one should be really clear. So the clarity on the need for it, for this transformation process, and the clarity on the expected outcome. So what do I expect? Another requirement is to make a deliberate effort to create time for it within the lesson, within the school program, and within the specific subjects. Moving to my last part of the last part of my address today, how to support learning, how to also support resilience building and learners' well-being, especially this during this new normal and this during this unprecedented times. The opportunities for children to identify and understand how the crisis has actually affected their sense of self and their sense of belonging. It's for enjoyment to address also emotions, songs, dance, those kind of issues. To create also hope activities is quite important in the new normal. Hope activities that helps promote gratitude. All of this will concur to empower the learner. And of course, the creation of experiential lessons and experiential alignments is quite key. Learning by doing. Assigning activities in which we will derive the learning objective. I'm going to end probably to talk about facilitating the learning from a day-to-day activity, which can pass through routine activities at home, like cooking, gardening, you name it, those kind of activities that the children has to do at home, and then which is happening at home, to engage the children in those routine activities and put the learning inside. I believe this is the transformation. This is how transformation could occur during this new normal. And of course, to leverage on the presence of child being at home to make learning as practical and experiential as possible. Lastly, to encourage working with siblings and other people at home. Definitely, this is one aspect that could be sized to overcome this period. And I would like to end my lecture today here and thank everybody for having your attention. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Job, for sharing your thoughts on leading transformational teaching in the new normal. So we have listened to the two keynote presenters and gave a brief overview about the topic that we have right now for the special lecture. So at this point, let us now focus. I'm sure most of our participants on YouTube, and shout out to the 500 plus with us on YouTube. We are also monitoring the YouTube feed, so you may type your comments there. And I'm pleased to inform all our participants that our officials and staff from SEAMEO are monitoring the chat in the YouTube. And also, as well, Dr. Lucio Sia, one of our keynote presenters, is also with us in the YouTube. So good morning to everyone. And now.
And we have also participants from many countries,
from
India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Thailand, and all the countries in Southeast Asia, and including in Paris.
Yes, and the 11 SEAMEO member countries also, a lot of participants from there. So good morning. And they are, I'm sure they're interested to know more about the videos that they have submitted to us when we made the call.
Yes, that's right. And how many videos we received, Rafi?
Yeah, we received about 50 videos. And much as we want to play them all, it would be impossible, but we selected 8 videos, but all of these videos shall be uploaded in our official YouTube account and also on our website.
Yes, sure.
So, partner Piapa, would you like to present the first chapter of the lectures that we will feature for today?
Thanks, Rafi. So the first chapter is about teaching innovation and models during the COVID-19 pandemic. And for this chapter, we have 2 presenters from the Philippines and who will give some ideas about the innovative models that you can apply for the online learning.
Yes.
So Dr. Angelica Cortez from the Nova Isihar University of Science and Technology, with her presentation topic, modular teaching in the new normal, which is very interesting.
Yes.
And the next presenter is Mr. Kiki Julie Angolo from Balai Lak University, Thailand. And he will give a comprehensive idea on the flipped classroom model. So it's quite interesting. And this is things that many teachers are asking, how they can organize the online teaching effectively. So let's enjoy the presentations.
A pleasant day to all. This is Angelica O. Cortez at the College of Education of Nova Ecija University of Science and Technology in the Philippines. And I am here to share one of our best practices entitled Modular Teaching in the New Normal. COVID-19 pandemic is a sad event, but can become an opportunity by making some adjustments, fine-tuning, and extra efforts. The leaders of NUSD Med conducted the SWOT analysis, replanned, reorganized, redirected, and eventually approved new plans and implemented all new and revised policies in response to the present situation. These were all done side by side, responding to the needs of stranded students in the locality and in their respective areas of training. Also, the university responded to the immediate needs of frontliners, such as boots, improvised face shields, face masks, sanitizers, and sanitizing boxes. We also organized and delivered social, psychological, and mental assistance through webinars, online guidance and counseling sessions, and we also launched various fora and hotline numbers for the concerns of parents and students. Moreover, all NUSD teachers were immersed in massive online trainings on the use of various platforms in teaching, along with participation in various webinars and workshops organized by local and international organizations and agencies like SEAMEO. All of these were materialized in real lives with teachers. To prepare the university for the opening of classes, we crafted, approved, and institutionalized various guidelines and policies on revisions of curriculum maps, revision of syllabi of instruction, and guidelines on flexible learning, such as in the online teaching and modular teaching. All this transpired because of teachers. Based from a survey conducted by the College of Education, 78% of our students have weak internet connectivity, 6% have no connectivity, and only 16% have good connectivity. Because of this, module is our official self-learning material. But how this module materializes into usable matter fit for our students in the current situation? Guidelines for writing the modules were made in place, and teachers were introduced to these guidelines. Teachers created the modules, underwent the evaluation of Instructional Material Development Committee of the college. These modules were subjected to flag scan and grammarly check before the same was submitted to the University Academic Standard Committee. The module must obtain an ASC certificate before it be bought, brought to the university printing press for production, sorting by teachers, and packing. Finally, the self-learning modules were distributed by teachers to their students. The making, reproduction, and delivery of self-learning materials to students were made possible by teachers. How do we do modular teaching in the new normal? Conventionally, modules are for distance learning and commonly used for asynchronous learning setup. But in order to assist our students who are used to face-to-face learning, we conduct modular teaching in synchronous setup with less financial requirements. How do we do it? Before classes begin, guidelines in the conduct of modular teaching in the new normal was established and approved. A new definition was made in place for the words modular teaching in the new normal, which means the use of modules in teaching aided by email, messenger, FB, SMS, and call in synchronous setup. Teachers were required to make their own classwork plan, and these were presented to students for information and guidance. The teacher requested also the students to create a group chat for the class. Step 1. Divide the class into smaller group or cluster, say 5 to 6 members per group. Each group must identify a leader. The primary duty of the leader is to ensure that members of the group are present during synchronous session. Also to facilitate submission of activity sheets in email, conduct of group learning activities to minimize copying and plagiarizing others' works. Step 2. Divide the class schedule into 3 parts, such that for a 3-hour class, it goes like this. Part 1 for the first hour. The teacher greets and checks the students of the class and gives instructions to read thoroughly with understanding the contents of the assigned unit for the day. Instruction can also be given to the leader to discuss the topic among the members of the group, encouraging clear teaching, and to come up with 2 to 3 questions about the lesson to be raised during the exchanges to happen in the second part. Part 2 for the second hour. The teacher gives the gist of the unit and answers all questions sent earlier by the students. And yes, despite having the self-learning module, students have lots of questions. In this second hour, the teacher may conduct recitation by text, by message, or by call. Showing here are the class interactions of teachers with students during synchronous modular teaching. On part 3, the last hour is the provision of instructions to students by teachers. For the students to start the day activity, for the deadline of the activity for the day, and the plan for the engagement next meeting. Showing now are the sample instructions given to students, their submitted outputs for the day, and how the modular synchronous class session ended. Step 3. Make a schedule on the giving of quiz, unit tests, and examination. It is advisable not to give a quiz or any form of test right after each engagement so as not to create stress and panic, especially for those students in the new normal. And that is how we do modular teaching in the College of Education of NEUST. Again, this is Teacher Angelica O. Cortez from the Nueva Ecija University of Science and Technology in the Philippines. Salute to all teachers.
Hello everyone, how are you doing? I hope you are doing well. My name is Kiki Julie Angoro, and in this video, I'm going to show you what I have been doing with my online classes, and I hope you find this video helpful. Okay, let's get down to business. I'm going to talk to you about a flipped classroom model to improve students' online EFL learning. I believe that all of you have heard of the word flipped classroom before. So this model consists of 2 sessions, namely the pre-class, which is online, and the in-class, which is face-to-face in classrooms. However, due to the pandemic, this model may not be very practical to use, right? Therefore, I adapted the concept and developed a new model, particularly for online instruction. So here in my model, there are also 2 sessions, the pre-online class, which I call asynchronous, and the in-online class, which I call synchronous. So the asynchronous session is a preparation phase. So I want the students to prepare themselves before meeting with me real time in the synchronous session. So in the synchronous session, it will be more about practice and feedback. Okay, now let's go to the first session, which is the asynchronous session. So here, I want the students to watch a short lecture video. So the key is the video should not exceed 15 minutes. because I don't want to discourage the students, right? So some students should not be lazy to watch short, brief, and informational videos. And after watching the videos, they need to do a mini online quiz. I do this because I want to confirm if the students have learned something from the video. And I use two platforms, Kahoot and Quizzes. The reason why I'm using these platforms is because they have been proven to improve students' learning motivation. So in a way, I want to encourage the students to do the quiz, right? And here, there are two pictures, right? In the first picture is my YouTube channel consisting the lecture videos, which are short. And in the second picture is an example of quizzes. Right, so here you can see that the students put their student ID number, so it's easier for me to observe who has and who has not completed the mini quiz. Okay. So now let's move on to the second session, which is the synchronous session. So as I told you earlier, the asynchronous session is the preparation phase, and I hope that for attending the synchronous session, the students have learned something. Therefore, in the synchronous session, I want to focus more on practice and feedback. And how I'm doing that is, first, I'm going to use, I'm using an online teleconferencing tool. I'm using a teleconferencing tool. So you can use Zoom, you can use Microsoft Teams, you can use Messenger Room. But in my case, I use WebEx. The reason is because my university bought WebEx, so it's free for me. But if your universities or schools bought Microsoft Teams or Zooms, feel free to use it. Okay? And actually, the key to a successful synchronous session for me is the second tool that I use, which is an online interactive response system, AirDAP. Okay. So here in this slide, I'm showing you three pictures of what I did in my, I think this one is writing class. So here you can see that I use WebEx to communicate orally with my students and also to see their faces. While I use Pear Deck to enable real-time practice for my students. So using Pear Deck, I can make students do some task, and I can observe their responses real time. So here you can see that students were writing some sentences, and here students were doing some matching activities, and I could see their responses in real time. And here is when I was giving them immediate feedback. So because I was able to observe their responses real time, I was able to give immediate feedback to my students. So if some students think that online class is boring, then they are not my students. Because in my online class, the students are very active and involved and engaged. Okay, I'm going to show you. So here, I'm talking about students' achievement and perception. So I did pre-test and post-test, and there was significant improvement, right? And students' perceptions. So I did a mini survey consisting of synchronous and synchronous sections. So in the asynchronous section, the means was 4.53 out of 5, and the synchronous 4.35 out of 5, this showed that students' perceptions were very positive. And here are some comments made by students about the model. So a student said, "I can understand the things that a teacher taught even if I'm at home, because he makes online class easier than other classes." And some students mentioned that the online class resembled normal face-to-face class, and said he taught me in the online, it didn't differ much to the classroom class, so I understand the lessons. Another student said, "I think my teacher is doing good and teaching effectively like in a normal class." And here, the last comment here is a student highlighting the use of Pear Deck. And he said, Pear Deck makes me more active in online classes. Right, so that brings me to the end of this video. So I have talked to you about a model that I have been using for my online class, which is called Flip Classroom Model for Online Class. And this model consists of two sessions, asynchronous and synchronous sessions. If you want to know more about this model, please feel free to email me at kiki.an@mail.wu.se.th. And you can also subscribe to my YouTube channel, Kiki Anggoro. Right, that's it from me, and I hope you find this video helpful. Thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.
So thank you for the presentations that submit to us. It's very useful topic. And we received many questions asking the how to get the details of the models that presented by mm-hmm. our speakers. Yeah. So that I would suggest that participants can review the YouTube again mm-hmm. if they mm-hmm. can catch up the email address of the speakers. Yes. So they can send the email directly to the speakers
yes.
for the additional information. So thank you very much for the very useful presentation from the speakers. So how about the next chapter, Rafi?
Okay, so after learning about the teaching innovations and models, the flipped classroom, the synchronous, asynchronous, let's now talk about the technology in education. So we have two videos that would introduce us to mobile learning, remote teaching using mobile learning. I'm sure mm-hmm. most of our YouTube participants are very interested to utilize the mobile technology as they transition from the usual face-to-face mm-hmm. to alternative modes of delivery. So we have Mr. Jomar Urbano from Nueva Ecija University of Science and Technology. He will talk about remote teaching using mobile learning. And Mr. Sami Q. Dolba from the Philippine Normal University, who will talk about what's in and what's out, the new normal classroom setup. So friends, let's enjoy these videos.
Good day, everyone. I'm Jomar M. Urbano, a faculty member of the College of Education. My task for this day is to present a teaching demonstration on how we can deliver remote teaching. I hope that the teaching techniques and strategies that I will try to incorporate in my discussion might help my fellow faculty members. But before we proceed to my teaching demonstration, let's have an overview of the class setup. Number one, students under remote teaching must have a printed copy of the module. Number two, for those who have access to the internet, videos will be uploaded to designated Facebook social learning group or Messenger group chat. Students can actually use free data in using Facebook Messenger as long as they have a good mobile data connection. And for those who do not have access to the internet, copy of the videos must be locally available or saved on their devices. And number three, students must have a mobile device or smartphone with load for sending SMS or text messages. The method that I'm about to use is called mLearning or mobile learning. Mobile learning is under the umbrella of remote teaching, since one of the ways on how to deliver this is through SMS or short message service or the text messaging. According to the International Telecommunications Union, Facts and Figures in 2019, mobile devices have spread at an unprecedented rate in the past decade, and 97% of the global population lives in an area covered by a mobile cellular network. In the recent report released by the dataportal.com last January 2020, Philippines has 159% mobile phone connections versus our population, meaning some Filipinos own two or more mobile devices. Based on the study of Pew 2017 and Poster 2016, the largest demographic of mobile device users worldwide is 18 to 29 years old, which is also the typical age of college students. And empirical evidence indicates that mobile learning supports students' learning in higher education settings. On a smaller scale, in the recent online survey conducted by our university, The data revealed that out of 17,169 students who participated in the study, only 27% have access to computers or laptops. In contrast, the remaining 73% have no access. Moreover, only 16% of MEUST students have full internet accessibility. 78% use their mobile data, and 6% have no access at all. Based on this data, we can conclude that mobile or smartphones are the most accessible way to reach out and teach our students during this pandemic. To do that, we can communicate with our students through SMS or text messaging. Of course, that includes the 6% with no internet access. Here at NEST, we believe that there should be no student left behind. So let us now proceed with my demonstration teaching on how we can deliver remote teaching using mobile learning. Good day, class. I am Jomar M. Urbano, your virtual teacher in our subject, Genetics or SEGS 14. And welcome to Co-Ed TV. I hope you are all doing good and safe at home. Before we proceed with our lesson, let me remind you of the things you must have while watching this video. Number 1, notebook and pen where you can take down notes. Number 2, printed module. Make sure that you have your printed modules with you in support of our discussions and activities. And number 3, for me to monitor your responses and feedback, you must have your smartphone or mobile phone with load. You need this to send your answers via SMS to the questions that will be flashed on this video. Always be alert with this signal icon. Every time you see this, you have to respond by answering the question and sending it to my cell phone numbers flashed on your screen. And you must follow this format every time you send messages. You have to write your name, section, question number, then your answer. For example, question number 1, what is peptidoglycan? After reading the question, you can type and send your answer right away. Also, be reminded to watch the video and send your answers within the scheduled time and day for our subject. I, as your teacher, will guide you to what, when, where, and how we can tackle a specific topic. If all is set, let us now have a recap of our lesson last time. So what was our topic last time? Exactly. We talk about DNA replication. And DNA stands for... And we also talk about RNA. And RNA stands for... And for the third question, why DNA needs to replicate? I will give you 1 minute to answer these three questions. And your time starts now. By this time, I should receive all of your answers to questions number 1 to 3. To begin with our today's lesson, let's read this trivia. Maybe a statement you hear again and again is, over 50% of our bodies are made up of water, which is true. But did you know that protein makes up 17% of our body? All of the protein within our body has a function, and none of it gets stored. One of the best examples of protein is the antibody that fights bacteria and viruses like SARS-CoV-2, which is the virus that causes COVID-19 disease. But have you ever wondered how proteins in our body are made? To answer that question, we will now discuss the topic entitled Protein Synthesis.
In this time of new crisis called COVID-19 pandemic, it is important to reach out to others who are not familiar with online classroom setup. It was in March 2020 when all students and teachers in the Philippines stopped classroom lectures, delayed the submission of students' outputs, postponed the tests, and shifted every school activities into virtual. One of the school big events was the student graduation. Different platforms emerged to deliver lectures to students. Adjustment is one of the big words that each student and teacher need to learn. Teachers will learn to manipulate different platforms, then they will choose which among is user-friendly for them and to their students. After learning and mastering the interface of the platforms, migrating lectures to the new normal classroom setup is another task to do. Using PowerPoint and PDF as the teaching materials for online classroom is easy to all teachers. But to know whether your students are attentive to your online lecture becomes more difficult. Connectivity to internet is unstable. Loading the Android phone to get internet is not enough for the whole day classes of a student. As an innovative teacher, I use OBS or Open Broadcast Studio software for my online video presentation for a synchronous lecture. Let me give you a short tutorial on how to use it.
Teachers, these are just some reminders. Now, whenever you go online, these materials are not needed. Classroom materials, chalk or marker, blackboard or whiteboard, manila paper, and of course, cartolina. Whatever topic discussion you're planning to write on them, they are not needed because you're not going to show them on cam. For decorations, definitely paper cutouts or handmade materials for decorations are not needed also, such as origami, posters, drawings, or pictures. These are the things that are out for the classroom online. When the teachers go online, what are the things they need to use and what are the things they need to manipulate? Let's see what's in. Materials are laptop, desktop with camera, Android phone, and tablet. It is not necessary that they need all of this, but at least one of them is enough for them to deliver their lecture online. Of course, those gadgets will be useless if connectivity is out. They need Wi-Fi, mobile data, and hotspot. These are the things you need when you're going to deliver your lectures online. And if teachers are ready with their gadgets and connectivity, they should also know what to include on their pre-recorded video lectures online. What are those? For green screen, they need emoticons, avatar, GIF, video, and of course, PowerPoint. You may have some of them ready for your discussions, but students are very much happy to see some emoticons, avatar, GIF, and your video lectures. This is the interface of the OBS application. You have the controls, streaming, and recording. So if you're going to start recording your video, press start recording. And here you have your sources wherein you are going to make ready of your virtual backgrounds. Before you start pressing or clicking the start recording here on the controls, you have to make ready your resources. For you to get all those virtual background, you're going to go to the sources, click plus sign, and you will see all different labels here. I want the steady virtual background, so I will use or click image, and then I will name it virtual background 1, and then I will click OK, then browse, find where it is located, but it's ready here. So I'm going to use the design one. So it will occupy the whole sphere. VB1 or virtual background 1 is on top of the sources. So I have here the virtual or the video capture device. Drag it up. And you see me there. I would like to add another image. VB3. Okay. And then browse. I will use my personal GIF. So let's see. I'm going to use this one. There you go. You can have as many as emoji, avatar, what else, GIF as you can on your screen. Okay. This time I'm going to show you my ready-made video for my discussion in a particular class of mine. I'm going to add here, click the plus sign, another VLC video source, then VBV3, because that's my third video. Oh, sorry, second video, I should say. So two, then okay. Then click the plus sign and add file. Then I will use this video. Then okay. Drag it to occupy the whole screen and look for your video capture device. Put it up or drag it up. Welcome back. You see me now on the screen. If I want to discuss about the video, so I have to talk first. I have to let them know what to be done. Also, if you want to add a video coming from a TikTok show or a TikTok user, and because that is a very educational, you can add that video. And I made it ready. So I will just click the eye to open it. There you go.
Okay, so there you have it from Mr. Jomar Urbano and Mr. Sami Q. Dolba. Tiapa, we have so many questions and comments on our YouTube channel, and mostly they're asking how to get copies of the PowerPoint, or yes. Some are having problems in internet connectivity. So, but this is on YouTube, and you can replay it when you have better internet connection. And to those who are asking more about how, there are specific questions related to the presentation, particularly on the remote teaching using mobile learning, and the new normal classroom setup, I think they have shared their email addresses, so you may coordinate with them. And in the first presentation of Mr. Jomar Urbano, he shared the YouTube link, yes, of the entire right. presentation, the sample online teaching demonstration. So we get so many responses on what DNA and RNA is, and
very difficult questions.
Very difficult question, but DNA deoxyribonucleic acid and RNA ribonucleic acid. Okay, so that's the second chapter. Piapa, would you like to introduce the third part of our lecture?
Well, the third chapter is about the practical education applications for the teachers. So we have two presenters from the Philippines. He will give us the guidelines how to implement the Facebook group announcement and Google Classroom attendance. And for the second speaker, from the Nova Isihar University of the Science and Technology, again, we'll present about the applying childhood for the learning process.
Yes, and I think one of our YouTube participants asked a specific question on how to manage student attendance. So I think this is very timely.
It's this part one can answer the question.
Yes, so friends, let's enjoy this video.
Ooh. This video is an entry to the call for teachers' videos by the Southeast Asian Ministers of Education Organization, or the SEAMEO, entitled Leading Transformational Teaching in the New Normal. Hello everyone, welcome. This is Mr. Raven Aledo from the University of the Philippines Rural High School, the Laboratory High School of the University of the Philippines Los Baños in Laguna, Philippines. In this video, you will learn how to give announcements using Facebook groups. And the second one, you will also learn how you can check using your Google Classroom and your Google Docs the attendance of your students, both in synchronous sessions and asynchronous learning. I hope that you will enjoy this video, and of course, do not forget to share this to anyone. All right, for giving announcements using Facebook group, you could click the Facebook group of your class and go to discussion, click what's on your mind, and then paste your announcement. Good day, class. You can now check on our Google Classroom stream for the new announcement. Thank you. What's the good thing about here is you could always click this one and then click pin on top to make sure that this announcement is the top post in that Facebook group. Another thing that I want to share to you is the checking of attendance. So you go to your Google Classroom stream, which we are using in our school, and then I just make a post about the Google Doc link of the attendance sheet. Now, how will the students edit this? To check, you go to your Google Drive and then go to that class attendance and then get link and then look for this options, anyone with link, and then click editor so that your students will be able to use the link to edit. Paste it here. Now you could check on them. For example, you click that and click open with Google Docs. You will be redirected to that file. And then you will see that your student could log in, edit, and then input their attendance record. Like for in my case, in my classes, I use smiley. So I ask my students to put a smiley on the cell opposite their name under the date for the day. Okay? And then you close that to make sure it's saved. And then go back to your Google Docs and then go to your Google Classroom. Now, you could also check another thing for attendance is the comment section. For example, in your classes, you could instruct your students to comment read and understood for you to know if they viewed the instructions and understood the instructions. You could also instruct them to ask questions on the comment section of your Google Classroom stream for you to know if there are problems that arise in the class time. That's how you could use Facebook group for your announcements and Google Classroom stream and Google Docs for attendance. All right. So what are the importance of the two things that I shared to you today? The first one, announcements, is to give the students a clear overview on what to do in the class. Even if you cannot see them, they will be guided on what are the things they need to do, they need to accomplish in your class. Now, the bad thing about Facebook Messenger when you give them announcement is that some things or some conversations actually overlap the other announcements. However, in Facebook groups, the good thing is you are able to pin post your announcement and they can just go back to that group to see again that announcement and be clarified in terms of the things that they need to know. Another thing is the attendance. Why do we have to check the attendance? Checking attendance is very important because attendance will tell you whether the students are able to access the materials or even the instructions that you give, especially when you are using Google Classroom in our case. Now, I hope that you learned something from this video, and I hope that all teachers out there will still fight amidst all the struggles that we are facing in this pandemic. Thank you, everyone. This is Teacher Raven.
Hello and good day, everyone. I am Pauline Joy R. Hanacho, a faculty member of NUST College of Education. We are continuing and are living amidst what is potentially one of the greatest threats in our lifetime to global education, a gigantic educational crisis due to COVID-19. Fortunately, we are seeing a lot of creativity and techniques in various universities in many countries, such as distance learning approaches. Distance learning is a powerful way to reach and involve students, including learning online, even when they are not in class. Removing the limits of conventional classrooms allows both educators and students versatility and easy access to learning, whether as part of a planned curriculum or as a necessary step due to external circumstances, according to M.K. Kellis 2016. In NUST, we believe that there should be no limits to when and where you can learn, especially at this time where education shifts from traditional models to the internet. Through this video, we can help you facilitate distance learning and connect with students even when they are not in class, and make it as impactful as a classroom experience. This learning method that I will share to you is called self-paced learning or student-paced learning. This method aims to promote learning at any time and anywhere. According to Priscilla 2020, self-paced learning approach provides students with the tools and assets they need in order to learn at their own pace and make choices about the sequence and focus on the learning. It is also a method in which the learner is able to control the amount of material they consume, as well as the time they need to learn the new information properly. On this video, I will share a step-by-step guide on how to assign student-paced games using Kahoot. And to give you a little background, Kahoot is a free game-based learning platform used as educational technology in schools and other educational institutions. Its learning games are user-generated multiple-choice quizzes that can be accessed via a web browser or the Kahoot app. Kahoot can be used to review students' knowledge for formative assessment or as a break from the traditional classroom activities. Student-paced game is called Challenge. A challenge can be played from anywhere and anytime on students' own devices. Here's how to assign a Kahoot as a challenge. You can assign Kahoots for self-paced learning by using challenges. Here's how you do it. Go to kahoot.com and log in or sign up. Open a Kahoot and click play and then assign. Follow the instructions and set a deadline when you'd like the game to be completed. You can also turn off the question timer to make the game all about accuracy and not speed. Toggle a friendly nickname generator on to avoid inappropriate nicknames. You can copy the link or the pin and share it with your students via Messenger, LMS, email, or by writing it on the whiteboard. Students can play Kahoot as a challenge on their computers or mobile devices at their own pace. Once the challenge is completed, you can view a detailed report by clicking on Reports. Click the challenge on the list. The insights will help you assess learning and plan your next class. You can try it too. I hope that the simple steps will help you make learning fast, easy, and enjoyable. This pandemic is very temporary, but we can take advantage of it by making learning extraordinary. Thank you, and God bless.
Wow, that's a very useful trick, right? For the teacher to apply, very little things, but very substantial for the teacher to apply in that online classroom. So thank you very much for the presenters. And for the next chapter, Rafi?
Yes, so we're down to the last chapter for this special lecture for the World Teachers Day. And after listening about teaching innovations, education technology, practical education applications, let's now talk about teaching science and English during COVID-19, because I'm sure in the previous lecture series you have shared with them about hospitality, engineering, modern agriculture, business. So now let's talk about strategies that would best teach science and English. So we have two lectures. The first one is Dr. Jutara Jitpani from Chiang Rai Rajabhat University, and she will be presenting the new challenge in English language teaching for teachers during the COVID-19 pandemic. And the second one is from Mr. Kurota Ayun from Semesta School Semarang in Indonesia, talking about being a science explorer during the pandemic. So friends, let us enjoy these lectures.
Very interesting, huh?
Sawadee ka. Hello, I'm Jutara Jitpani from Chiang Rai Ratchaphat University, Thailand. Today, I would like to present about new challenges in English language teaching for teachers during the COVID-19 pandemic. So it's kind of reflection from, you know, one voice of English teachers in the context of Thailand. Right, so let's getting to know about me a little bit. Yes, so as I presented, my full name is Jutara Jitpani, and I also have my English name, Honey. Okay, so here's the backgrounds of my education. Basically, I just finished my bachelor degree and master degree in Thailand and my PhD in China. Right, and my current positions, I'm an English lecturer at Faculty of Humanities and also a vice lecturer of Institutes of International Languages and Cultures, right? And if you would like to contact me, you can write me an email, through Hotmail here. So here's my email address. Okay, so during the pandemic, I was assigned to teach two main courses, referring to socio-cultural backgrounds of English native speaking countries. So, I have to teach 117 Thai students. And another course is ASEAN Studies. So I have to teach two groups of students, referring to 31 Thai students and 44 Chinese students. So according to these two courses, I use useful digital applications for my classes here. So for a group of Chinese students who are in China, so I use WeChat, TikTok, and Zipgrid, and Hotmail, okay? Basically, I WeChat to communicate with them, send them the file, or you know, just a direct message to them like that. But if I would like to do a video conference, I prefer to use TikTok, okay, because it can record the videos while doing a video conference, like a Google Meet like that. And SIFGRADE helped me, you know, in terms of deciding the test, checking the score immediately after student finish quiz, finish examination like that. And for Hotmails, okay, I use it for student, you know, to submit their work through the email, because in China they still can use Hotmail. But for a group of Thai students, I prefer to use Gmail, Google Classroom, Google Form, Facebook, and Facebook Messages. So from these useful digital applications in here, you know, I apply actually a lot of techniques and approaches during I faced with the situations of pandemic, right? And I also consider about what can I do, because previously I just teach students face to face. I never used like 100% online like this before. So yeah, I mainly apply blended learning approach, jigsaw technique, questioning techniques, project-based learning. Just like a course of socio-cultural backgrounds, I also like use a questioning technique in a class a lot, because if I just open for like, okay guys, you have any question, then no voice from them. So that is why I have to call them, okay, randomly call them the name, and then let them answer the question of mine. And then in terms of jigsaw technique, for example, I ask them, like I ask student each of them to work on different topics, and when is time for a live live teachings and learning, then they have to share their own information like that. And for project based, this one is very important, because it's after I finish like the first half semester, then the second half of the semester, I prefer to use like project based for students to apply the concept that they have learned in the first half of the semester into the real practice, you know. Yeah, so blended learning is, of course, that is a mix of online activities that I ask students to do, you know. So these are the practical teaching techniques that I have like applied during the pandemic. And what I found, the difficulties in teaching online, is that I found that, you know, the heart of the online teaching refer to internet signals. So it must be very strong. And many times, like, I got the problem because it's weak, sometimes it's down, and then I have to sign in, sign out so many times like that. And also the problem with the computer, sometimes it's work too long and then it's become like very hot, and then it stopped working sometimes. Yeah. And the third point is one, you know, particularly for student group, because many of them just like have small smartphone, which is like have limited space, you know, and many times that is not matched with the application that we selected, okay, in the classroom. And sometimes it's not matched with the version that we uploaded sometimes. So that is why students face the problem of this kind of devices, you know, and some of them have no computer. So that is the problem, yeah. And then from this problem, you know, I try to solve the problem, okay, by record the offline teaching videos. So I'll just like, I will record the video first, and then when it's time of the class time, then I will upload. And if it's like has three periods of time, then the first two periods, I ask them to watch the offline teaching videos. And then the last periods of time, I will have the video conference with them to follow up their understanding. I ask them some questions and also open floor for them to ask me or consult me about the main contents that they have learned, and also the assignment that I assign them. So if I assign them to do something, I will provide the easy channel for them to submit. They can choose either email, Google Classroom, or Facebook group. So that is all about my experience during the pandemic situation. Thank you. สวัสดีค่ะ.
Hello, everybody. I'm Kuradam, biology teacher of Susa School. During the pandemic of coronavirus, over 50 million students in Indonesia are out of classroom, affecting their education in unprecedented ways. For this reason, they have to learn from home without classroom activities and the presence of their friends. However, with the support of technology, we can overcome these challenges.
Ah, I got that. Check this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, I've got the result. Shining bird of paradise. Okay. Yep. Yeah.
I was not finding a Pokemon. Actually, I was doing a demonstration to guide my students what they have to do. They have to identify plants or animals in their surroundings, such as mango trees or cats or birds as their friends. After that, they should write its characteristics, its scientific classification, and its descriptions. I've informed my students to use the apps for identifying plants or animals. The apps are available on Google Play Store or App Store, such as Google Lens, Plant Snap, or Pictures. They can use the best apps as they want. I'm really sure that the task will make them more curious and give them insight about the species information. Here is the example of my students when doing the task.
Hi everyone, I'm Olivia. Biology is one of my favorite subjects. I'll be excited if my teacher gave us a task to explore the surroundings. Anyway, I just got the information from my teacher that there will be a task to do. I'm sure this task will be exciting and makes me feel like a real science explorer during the pandemic. Moreover, I only need my smartphone to scan and identify the plants or animals. Hi Lenny, let me identify you. As you can see, she is a Persian cat or Pelecanthus. Now I want to identify my plant. As you can see, it's a Cambodian dragon tree. Right there. Mm. Last but not least, I'm going to identify my plant. As you can see, it's a butterfly gardenia.
Yeah.
That's all of my biology exploring for today. Although I did this activity in my home, it's still entertaining, challenging, and educating. I hope this pandemic will be over soon. Thank you, see you later.
Good morning, class.
Good morning,
good morning, sir.
How are you today?
I'm fine, thank you.
Thank you.
Before we start this online learning, I'll check the students' attendance. Okay, no one is absent. Alright, please come in class. Meet your friends to pray together right now.
Please, friend, before we start this online learning, we pray together.
Amen. So, today, we are going to discuss about biology task that I gave to you last week. Now I choose a student. Please, Alina, present your report to your friends.
Hi friends, today I'm going to present my report about the project last week.
That's all of my video. I hope you can find an inspiration from this video. Thank you and see you later.
Okay, so thank you very much. We have We have watched Dr. Jutarat and from Kurota Ayun from Indonesia as they shared with us the teaching of science in English. So we have learned a lot from them, particularly on the usage of applications and other innovative teaching strategies. So thank you very much. And we have so much comments, so much interaction in our YouTube live.
Yes.
And I'm sure they're very interested to know more about what's going to happen next after this, because we're done. We have featured all the 8 video clips. So a lot of things will be happening. And I'm sure they noticed the 55, that green logo on top of our screen right now. So Piapa, can you share with us what can they expect in the coming days and weeks as we celebrate the 55th anniversary of SEAMEO?
Right, thanks, Rafi. Before that, I would like to inform all the participants and the teachers who submit the clip that all the video clips submit to SEAMEO for this topic will be uploaded on the SEAMEO website.
Yes,
so
yes.
That the teachers, not apart from the video that we presented today, mm-hmm. so they can view the other videos that are useful for their for the improvement of their teaching for the online classes. So we will upload all the videos, including the video of today, on the SEAMEO website. So you can review again on the SEAMEO website. And apart from that, let me give you the information regarding the SEAMEO 55 anniversary. And we are launching a program, many programs lining up for the institutions, teachers, and students to join us. So the first program we call SEAMEO School Network 2020, and this open for all educational levels in Southeast Asian countries, including kindergartens, primary school, secondary school, vocational school, polytechnics, and university, and also including the special education centers and non-formal education center can be applied to be part of our SEAMEO School Network. And it's free to join, so you will not need to pay anything for SEAMEO, because we will give you a very useful information in terms of the webinar programs, scholarships, competitions, awards that the institution, teachers, and students in your institution can join us. So you can scan the QR code here and fill up the very simple application to be part of our network. And for the next program, we call SEAMEO Photo Contest.
Yes, I'm sure, very interesting.
That's right, because not normal for us to organize the photo contest. And this is to celebrate the 55 anniversaries. And with the theme reimagining the education, science, and culture, and we welcome students, teachers, and any occupations to submit the photo, you know, that telling about the education, science, and culture to us. And the deadline is 15 November. So if you want to have like more information, please read the guidelines carefully. And the submission can be through the online as well. So it's on the banner at
the moment. Yes, yes. The QR code is there. Yes.
And how about the other activities, Rafi? I'm sure that you have like more to inform the participants.
More. So as we celebrate the 55th anniversary of SEAMEO, so just like this special lecture, we would like to invite everyone for the SEAMEO Youth Action on COVID-19, or what we call the SEA competition.
Yes.
So just like this lecture series, the SEAMEO lecture series, we would like to invite you to submit to us video clips, 3 to 5 minutes. The link is
and
provided.
And this must be the students, right?
Yes, this so should be for the students.
They can perform in the one person or perform in a group as well.
Yes, as well. So it can be individual or group video or vlog, and you can share it with us. Just like the teachers who have shared with us their own personal blogs, their own channels, YouTube channels. So we're inviting all our youth participants to give us, so they can learn more about it if they will visit the link.
And they can dance.
Yes, yes.
And they submit the video to us.
Yes.
Wow, that's interesting.
And then we also have, so this one, with the photo contest, we also have an essay writing contest. So this contest is open for primary, secondary, and tertiary students. So if you have students who are very good in writing and would be interested to join, please click that link or scan the QR code so that they will be able to understand the guidelines that govern this essay writing contest, and the deadline is actually next week, October 24. Mm-hmm. So it's fast approaching. So please help us in disseminating this information, that so that we can also feature this with the theme Stronger Together for Quality, Accessible, and Responsive Education.
Interesting.
And also on April 28 to 29 next year, 2021, mm-hmm. we will have our SEAMEO Congress. Mm-hmm. So it will be here in Bangkok in Thailand, but we would like to invite everyone for a call for papers. So the details are there. If you will just look mm-hmm. at the website also, we have placed the website there. So we're urging everyone to visit our website so that they will know more as we celebrate the 55th anniversary of SEAMEO.
So the teachers can submit the abstracts, right?
Yes,
to the
yes.
committee, and then we will select the abstract for
yes.
the presentation.
Correct,
oh, that's
correct.
Great.
So we're inviting everyone, particularly those, the 600, more than 600 with us on YouTube, please inform your friends as well and peers if they are interested to submit their abstracts to us.
That's cool.
And now let's go to the most asked question. A number of our participants are asking about this, how to get the certificate of participation.
Thank you, Rafi. So as normal, we will request all the participants who join us in the webinar or in this lecture series to fill up the certificate validation form after watching the lecture, or even right now, you can
yeah.
you know, take out your mobile and scan the QR code, and then you enter your information. But please ensure that the spelling of your name and email address is correct before submitting, because we will generate the certificate by using the
system,
which we are not able to fix the certificate after we send the certificate to your email address. And please give time to us for 1 month to generate certificate for you. And by the way, mm-hmm. this link will be closed at 11 p.m. today.
Yeah.
So you would have about how many hours?
So it's 11, so about 12 hours
for you to fill up this application form for the e-certificate of participation for the lecture series today. So, you know, easy way, you know, just scan the QR code and enter your information.
Okay. So thank you very much, Piapa, and to all our participants on YouTube. We have reached the end of this special lecture as we celebrate the World Teachers Day with all of you, the educators. And I hope that you have learned. All the videos as we have shared will be uploaded on our website and on our official YouTube channel. So from all of us here in SEAMEO Secretariat in Bangkok, Thailand, we say thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your participation.
And we hope to see them once again in the next,
learning
events organized by SEAMEO.
Thank you very much and see you again in our next event. Bye-bye. Have a good day and take care for all of you.
Opportunities by working hand in hand together, accomplish all.